There was a time when I was a televangelist. I had my own cable TV show, with a choir, an orchestra, a soprano soloist. My sermons were a combination of scripture, religious dogma, and off-color stories and jokes based on my new and revised Bible, which juxtaposed both religious and secular material, both the sacred and the profane. Or I just sit back and relax and I wouldn't say anything. I just gaze off into the middle distance, lose track of the fact that I was on television, and I'd doze off. Or I'd get up and make myself a sandwich. And there was nothing saccharine or cloying or smarmy or ingratiating about me. I was the first honest, though perhaps mentally deranged, demagogue on television. So I would sell these new and revised Bibles that included both secular and religious material, and I'd conduct telethons to raise money for the small church that I'd founded. And eventually I accumulated enough money to buy my own cable TV station, and then I had my own unique program in which I was televised 24 hours a day. I was always on camera. There was not one private moment in my life. You'd see me wandering around my house, watering my lawn, putting up storm windows, weeding my garden, or rotating the tires on my car, vacuuming the interior, changing the oil and transmission fluid. Or sometimes you'd see me in my swimming pool, lying back on a rubber raft, a drink with a little paper umbrella floating in a styrofoam container beside me. Usually Meyer's rum with Campari and equal parts of bitters and quinine water. And my camera crew would follow me everywhere. Once I drove to a local bar, and I remember that night I drank too much and was barely able to make it home after weaving from lane to lane up the highway. And then you could see me fumbling for my keys at the door of my house before suddenly urinating behind some bushes, and then groping at a window attempting to get in, until finally, frustrated, I passed out unconscious on the front lawn. And the camera crew also followed me into a brothel, and the fact that I was not a very good lover with almost no control and was not very well endowed either, and that I wasn't ashamed of this, that I in fact celebrated it, that I recognized that I was just an ordinary man, was very liberating for many viewers. And people who had no faith began to watch my program, because it seemed to mock a world in which youth, beauty, wealth, power, physical strength, sexual prowess, political clout were the most valued assets. The fact was, and it still is, that the vast majority of the people who live in this country exist in a world in which they feel alienated, and I legitimize their existence by my simplicity and my subversive nature, and I made them feel as though they were the real people, and that the media images were simply false representations. And so I tapped into a huge audience of Americans that were disaffected, who felt that they didn't really have a stake in this country, who were beset by a vague sense of anxiety, a disquietude that haunted them as though a waking nightmare. Of course, there were many other people who thought the program was a complete put-on, and that I was ridiculing my religious followers, while the people who had religion believed that I was consumed by the madness of God. And soon people began turning away from the networks, away from Fox and NBC and CBS and ABC, because their programming was so predictable, so obvious, so formulaic, while with my show, you never knew what was going to come next. And so I was enormously successful. I made the covers of Time and Newsweek for my truly unique and refreshing approach to quasi-religious broadcasting. And sometimes I'd get in my car and take a long trip. And I had a communications van that followed me around and a camera that transmitted my image to the van behind me, which was uplinked to a satellite, so that we could transmit a live picture of me driving my car and follow me anywhere. And in fact, on one occasion, I drove down to Key West, stopped at various motels along the way, drank a huge quantity of scotch, gambled heavily on a riverboat, picked up a few prostitutes. And also, I like to fish, and so I got out of the car from time to time, and I just dropped a line off of a bridge, and so for a few hours, you'd see me standing there with a fishing pole. And all the time, crawling across the screen at the bottom, was the 800 number to call to buy my Bibles. So this new religion that I created became enormously popular because it was all-embracing. It accepted rather than denied. It encouraged rather than prescribed against. It revealed many roads as opposed to one road and respected what is human in us, our infinite variety. This religion I founded recognized those differences, and it celebrated them. And it was a very freeing and exhilarating faith, and people flocked to it. In fact, so many people attempted to come to the services at the TV church that there just wasn't enough room for them all, and that's when I decided to open up other churches exactly like my own. And sell the franchises, churches with exactly the same dimensions, furnished with the same pews, with identical cushions and pulpits and candelabra and crucifixes and collection boxes and silver chalices, and also provided were a scepter, an incense burner, a decanter for holy wine and water, a cruet for vinegar, another for oil. And the holy water was produced and bottled at a plant in Ohio and personally blessed by me. And there were also soaps and emollients and oils and perfumes and incenses and cassettes of my sermons. And of course, the new revised Bible, which were for sale to the public in the front of the church, in the church store. And there was also a mail order catalog with an 800 number. It was a McDonald's Burger King kind of operation. You could assemble an entire church in 18 hours. The churches were 28 by 56 feet and could hold about 150 people. They were prefabricated, modular. You'd simply bolt everything together. They had stained plexiglass windows with pictures of a lion lying down with a lamb, Jesus feeding the poor by multiplying a single fish and a single loaf of bread so that 10,000 fish sandwiches could be served, and pictures of the Sermon on the Mount and Lazarus raised from the dead and the Last Supper. And if McDonald's had the golden arches, what was going to be the symbol of my church? And I finally decided on a pair of candlesticks on either side of an open Bible and the phrase, "Light the Way." And soon my churches were all over America. And we had signs above them that said, 100 million Bibles sold. And as we increased our sales, the digital number changed daily from 100 million to 110 million to 120 million and so on. And you could purchase a franchise for $160,000. And you could order your own clerical collar, your own robes, all the standardized vestments. But then, at the height of my success, I suddenly felt haunted and troubled. Something was not right. I didn't feel as though I was in control of my life. I felt as though my life was running me. I had dreams that I couldn't shake of falling, of drowning, of suffocating. And even though I had everything I wanted, or thought I had everything I wanted, somehow I felt lonely, frightened. I experienced a sense of emptiness, of meaninglessness. I was in a state of despair. But on my TV show, I was completely honest about my spiritual crisis. I did not try to hide it. The fact that I was losing my faith, that I was experiencing this malaise, turned out to be a tremendous boon. If I was big before, I was even bigger now, because my audience were people just like me, who were struggling with their own faith as well. And so my spiritual crisis led to a profound groundswell of participation with calls and letters and even more money. Until one night, when the cameraman who was supposed to be monitoring me in bed fell asleep, and I slipped out of bed on camera, and then I walked out of the frame because I decided that the only way to get out of this horrible rut was to go back to my roots, sneak out of the compound without anybody's knowledge, and get into the old car which I'd saved, in which I used to drive around the country selling my Bibles. But you see, I was so famous then that I had to disguise myself. And so I wore a wig and a false mustache with mutton chops, and I wore thick glasses and platform shoes and contact lenses which changed the color of my eyes. And I also padded my clothes to make myself look 30 pounds heavier. And so I drove off in my old car, piled high with the Bibles like in the old days. And I disappeared, miraculously. Some of my most religious followers believed that I'd become cosmic and insubstantial, that I'd dropped my body, and that I was no longer encumbered by fleshly matters and daily travails, but had risen above all that, and like a true celestial being, governed from everywhere at once. But what in reality was happening was that I was driving across the country anonymously, staying in motels, trying to come to grips with the despair that I was feeling. And then, finally, I was in the desert in the southwest, and I'd been driving at night, and now dawn was coming up, and it was in the middle of the summer, very hot, and I had no water, and I was out there in the desert, hundreds of miles away from anything, utterly lost. And then my car ran out of gas, and the day was hellishly hot, and I staggered from the vehicle just in time to see it burst into flames. And the car was now burning, and I watched it as it continued to burn, but was not consumed. And this became a deeply religious experience. Somehow I felt as though I was present at a seminal moment in my life, a turning point in my existence. And for days I watched my automobile as it continued to burn. And the thirst I had felt was relieved. I no longer felt pangs of hunger, and my beard stopped growing. And finally, the fire went out, and the car remained. And I got in, and the steering wheel was still a bit hot, and the upholstery was smoking, and so I had to get out again and wait a few more hours till the car cooled off. And that night, at about 3 a.m., when the car was comfortably warm, but not too hot to the touch, I turned the ignition, stepped on the accelerator, and miraculously, the car started. And then I drove back to the compound, which had been surrounded by reporters and grief-stricken followers, to whom I once again became the shepherd. Once there was a man cursed with eternal life. He outlived his family, his children, his business, saw the house in which he was first brought up disintegrate around him. He saw his friends and lovers become old and die, while he remained a man who appeared never to age, with abundant sandy hair, a ruddy, healthy complexion, always slim and youthful. He saw generations come and go, governments rise and fall, national boundaries shift. He saw the map of the world redefine itself. He saw styles of music, clothing, popular culture change. He saw disease after disease eradicated, only to be supplanted by more horrific ailments, none of which ever touched him. He seemed immune to the most basic of all of the processes which are inherent in the passage of time. the mortality of all human beings who walk the inevitable, ever-narrowing path of life towards the horizon, the vanishing point where all creatures flash from existence. He seemed to tread that path as a wheel upon which he could remain forever along the edge, walking the surface of a sphere and never being consumed into the diminishing parallax of life's long line of days that inevitably run out for mortals into night. And at a certain point, he fell into a profound depression because he had lost so many lovers, so many friends. And whenever he would strike up a new love affair or a friendship, he would know from the very beginning that it would be ultimately doomed. He would see that person grow old and die. And he also found that everything that seemed important at any particular time in history became insignificant and utterly meaningless later on. He looked with increasing skepticism upon people whose passions governed their activities, people who were politically motivated and would vehemently preach one ideology or another, who argued for radical change, the overthrow of political systems, who would blow themselves up in public places, because he would see over the course of hundreds of years that all these movements, all these religions would either evolve into something entirely different or would die away or become exactly the opposite of what the founders conceived. And consequently, he saw the futility, the vanity, the irony of impassioned political activity, that it all cooked down to passionate irrelevance in the long scheme of things. He had been born in the time of the ancient fathers of the Old Testament, in the time of Abraham, and he had accompanied the Jews of Babylonia into Egypt, and he was a slave there for 400 years, and then, accompanying Moses and Aaron, left Egypt and wandered the desert for 40 years, and after passing through the parted waters of the Red Sea, he gained the land of Canaan, growing up in Mesopotamia, in what would later be known as the Bronze Age. He journeyed first into Europe during the early Middle Ages after the spread of Islam drove him from his home in Jerusalem, and he saw the rise of medieval cathedrals, the establishment of the early European kingdoms of Cologne, Navarre, Aragon. He saw the first popes, and he observed their excesses in Rome. And as he traveled north, he began to sense the fervor of the Reformation, and he actually met Martin Luther. He was at the cathedral and handed the nails to Martin Luther when he hammered his 95 theses to the door. And he was also in France during the French Revolution and stood there with the crowds, watching the aristocrats being taken to the guillotine in their carts. And he was even there to hear Lenin's speech at the Finland station. The trains were running late. He had gone to redeem a round-trip ticket to St. Petersburg, and he was standing at the ticket window, arguing about the price of his refund. And inadvertently, he was caught up in the fervor of the audience, listening to Lenin's speech. And now, years later, he's working as a writer on one of the most popular TV sitcoms. He lives alone in West Hollywood. He takes Prozac and other antidepressants, sees a psychiatrist 4 times a week, has tried to kill himself 3 times in the last 2 years. But of course, he's been unsuccessful. And what does this story tell us? Well, in a very subtle way, it suggests a willingness to hear dissonance in the music of the spheres and dance to it.
You've been listening to Joe Frank. This is part of the program called Red Sea. It was produced in 1996 for Somewhere Out There. To listen to the entire show, go to joefrank.com.